Our next guest is a production designer, costume wizard, and one half of Aussie cinema's royal couple.
Catherine Martin is adored the world over, and she's got the hardware to prove it.
And the Oscar goes to Catherine Martin.
Catherine Martin.
Catherine Martin.
Catherine Martin.
She's Australia's most decorated Academy Award winner, with an incredible 9 nominations and 4 wins to her name, along with a slew of BAFTAs and a Tony Award thrown in for good measure.
Sweetheart, I reckon 4 Oscars can't be wrong.
She's the woman behind the stunning worlds created for Romeo and Juliet, Strictly Ballroom, The Great Gatsby, and more recently, Elvis. But it's Catherine's work on Moulin Rouge that's proved some of her most legendary. Now she's celebrating Moulin Rouge the musical, which has dazzled the nation and is taking a victory lap.
So exciting, the audience will stop and cheer. So delighting, it will come for 50 years. Spectacular, spectacular.
No, please welcome Catherine Martin.
Yeah.
We need to ask about what you are wearing. You look fabulous.
It's an ode to Satine, the sparkling diamond.
Oh, yes.
It's from my favourite Prada. Who I've had the great pleasure of collaborating with on a number of shows on The Great Gatsby, both with Miu Miu and Prada, the two labels. Mutual Prada's been incredibly supportive of our work. And also, Miu Miu worked with me on the costumes for Priscilla in Elvis.
Oh, wow.
I mean, you were never going to turn up in tracksuit pants.
No, that's
let's
right.
Be honest,
yeah.
If the truth be told, I probably would have.
Oh,
I knew I had to. There were expectations.
Now, Moulin Rouge the musical, it's been running somewhere in the country for the last 2 years. I think like 1 million people across Australia have
yeah,
seen
over
it.
Over 1 million
wild.
People.
Unreal.
It's absolutely incredible. And we're just so thrilled that the homegrown crowd has embraced the show. Mm. And it's been extraordinary that a company like Global Creatures, another extraordinary woman who runs it, Carmen Pavlovich, that she saw the need to make product that was homegrown and that could be developed here in Australia and then be taken to the world. And that's something, certainly a vision that she and Baz share and I share. And I think that's one of the extraordinary things about this show. It's not only killing it here, but we have it in many productions. It's in German, it's in Japanese, it's in Korean. So it's really thrilling.
I mean, it's 20 years or so after the movie. I love Moulin Rouge, the movie. And I can remember thinking when I was watching it, I was like, hang on a second, that track didn't belong in 1890 France. But that's what was so spectacular about it. When you look back at the people who were maybe a bit mad that you'd kind of done that, do you go, sucked in, I was right?
Well, I wasn't the one with the great initial idea. I must give that credit to the impresario, Mr. Baz Luhrmann. But look, I think that's the great pleasure of working with him as a creator, is he has a very forward-thinking process. Mm. And I think also he's able to really connect with an audience and find things that will touch and move people from all different walks of life and all different nationalities. So it's about the specific, I think, and also about a kind of very touching and inclusive way of telling stories.
Mm. Mm. And now you've worked with so many different eras, bringing them to life in your various films and projects. What's your favourite, if you could live in one?
Well, look, that's a very difficult question because each era has to become like a child. Yeah. There are no favourites because if you start to...
Everyone has a favourite child. We know they do.
Like, you couldn't do the 90s.
I don't. Egg and Lily, I don't. These women, I don't know what they're saying. Look, I do gravitate very much to the 20s and 30s. Mm. But then you will find that the 20s and 30s takes inspiration from other periods, so you kind of go on a snakes and ladders between periods. You'll see that in the 70s there was a great deal of influence that came from the 20s and 30s. There was a very famous, very trendy department store in London called Beaver. If you look it up on the interweb, you will see how all these things kind of cross, fertilise across periods. But yes, I do lean in, particularly in the interior space, into a kind of an Art Deco vibe.
Love that. And I have to ask, were you behind the fish tank in Romeo and Juliet? Because that has really seeded into all of my romantic fantasies, seeing someone through a fish tank. I've been asked to leave aquariums. I've been asked to move along.
When Baz was writing Romeo and Juliet in Miami, because originally we were going to set it in Miami, like in real Miami, and we went there as youngsters, and we went to a club to have dinner that started off as a club, and then you could have dinner and stuff. And he went into the bathroom, and it was there in the nightclub bathroom, and that became his starting point. He was washing his hands, and he looked up, and he saw a woman across, not me, some other woman across in the thing, and he went, what a wonderful way of connecting through an aquarium.
Oh, and all these years later, Nikki gets chucked out of aquariums.
But not bathrooms. They're just the place being squished.
Yeah. Moulin Rouge, the musical, is back in Melbourne now. All the info is on our website, which please thank Catherine Martin.